Amid the deafening traffic of the town, tall, slender, in deep mourning, with majesty a woman passed, raising with dignity in her poised hand the flounces of her gown, graceful, noble with a statue's form. And I drank, trembling as a madman thrills, from her eyes, ashen sky where brooded storm, the softness that fascinates, the pleasure that kills. A flash, then night. Fugitive, I am suddenly reborn from your swift glance. Shall I never see you till eternity? Somewhere far off? Too late? Never perchance? Neither knows where the other goes or lives. We might have loved, and you knew this might be. My heart that seemed a bird was gliding in the sun, and joyous, free about the rigging, swerved at play. The ship, too, like a sun-drunk angel flown astray, under the clear blue, happily skimmed on and on. What is that somber island like a low, dark wall? Cythera, someone says, a country famed in song, trite Eldorado of bachelors no longer young. Look, it is only an arid country after all. of magic love rites and sounding lyre, sure of delicious secrets. Like a fragrance there, the shade of Venus glides upon the sea-washed air, drugging the very soul with languor and desire. Fresh myrtled island, garden still unwithering, your long renown by every human tongue confessed to the far-scattered nations of east and west, diffuses like the incense of full-blossomed spring or a dove's endless cooing. Cythera was no more than a terrain of rock and scrub, a dismal reach of emptiness disturbed by an occasional screech. I saw one curious object, though, along that shore. It was no vine-girt temple where, with vague desire, robe loosened to the breezes, the young priestess went among green arbors, mingling with the rose's scent, that of her pulsing body in its secret fire. No. But we did see, following the coast so near that frightened birds were scolding and beating upon our sails, a solitary gibbet with three branching rails against the sky like a black cypress, sharp and clear. In an obsessive way, a hanged man, duly ripened, with assured technique, perched on their prey, each planting like a tool his beak in every bleeding corner of that rich decay. The eyes were holes. The heavy coil of entrails fell streaming onto the thighs from where the belly gaped, and, taking care no hideous delight escaped, those glutted bravos had unmanned their victim as well. Below the feet, a pack of jealous quadrupeds, their lifted muzzles trained upon the dwindling feast, slunk, pivoting upon themselves. One taller beast moved like an executioner along his aid. Son of Cythera, remnant of a world so brave, how silently, with your black hollow eyes of woe, you took these insults, paying for I do not know what shameful cults and sins forbidding you the grave. Ridiculous hanged creature, who are you but I? Before your dangling limbs I felt, corrosive, strong, like a bitter vomit rise to my teeth, the long stream of affliction suffered in the time gone by. At sight of you, poor devil, I could feel the fresh rage of the past upon me. Every beak and tooth of those black panthers and large crows that in my youth so dearly loved to lacerate and grind my flesh. Reeking shade of that symbolic tree, my heart was wrapped as in a heavy winding sheet. Nothing besides, O Venus in your island, just that mournful allegory to welcome me at length. Almighty God, give me the courage and the strength to contemplate my own true image without disgust. Flasks of expensive scent, embroideries, rich brocades, taffeta sofas, satin chairs, statues in marble, paintings, fragrance that pervades the empty, sumptuous gowns, warm air. Dying bouquets in their glass coffins give a stale, voluptuous chamber. Lying here, a corpse without a head, whence flows in a bright stream, making an ever-broadening stain, the red and living blood which the white pillows seem to lap up like a thirsty flame. Shapes that out of shadow stare, chaining our helpless eyes to theirs. The head, with its great mass of rich and somber hair, the earrings still in the small ears, like a ranunculus on the night table sits, and void of thought, blank as the light of dawn, A glinting, vague regard escapes from its eyeballs, uprolled and china white. The headless trunk, in shameless posture on the bed, naked in loose abandon lies, its secret parts exposed, its treasures all outspread as if to charm a lover's eyes. One sequined stocking, pink against the milky thigh, remains pathetic souvenir. The jeweled garter, like a flashing secret eye, darts and withdraws a diamond leer. A languorous portrait on the wall contrives to give force to the singular effect. The eyes provocative, the pose inviting, half erect. The ghost of something strange and guilty, of some feast involving most improper fare. Demoniac kisses, all obscure desires released, swims in the silent curtains there. And yet, that fragile shoulder, that fine hand and arm, how delicate the curve they make. The pelvic bones so sweetly pointed, the whole form lithe as a teased and fighting snake. She must have been quite young, her senses, all her soul, avid for life and driven wild by tedium, set ajar, it may be, to the whole pack of perversions. Ah, poor child. Seated at length, that man, his awful thirst, too great for living flesh to satisfy, on this inert, obedient body consummate his lust? Oh, ravaged corpse, reply! Answer me, impure thing! Speak, frightening head, and tell, lifting you up by your long hair, did he on your cold teeth imprint in last farewell one kiss before he set you there? Magistrate, sleep in peace. I leave you lying as you are, mysterious and fortunate. In vain your lover roves the world. The thought of you troubles each chamber where he lies. Even as you are true to him, he will be true to you, no doubt, until he dies. Sometimes, to entertain themselves, the men of the crew lure upon deck an unlucky albatross, one of those vast birds of the sea that follow unwearied the voyage through, flying in slow and elegant circles above the mast. And this aerial colossus, shorn of his pride, goes hobbling pitiably about the planks and lets his great wings hang like heavy, useless oars at his side. How droll is this poor, floundering creature! How limp and weak, he but a moment past so lordly flying in state! They tease him. One of them tries to stick a pipe in his beak. Another mimics with laughter his odd lurching gait. Thank you. The poet is like that wild inheritor of the cloud, a rider of storms, above the range of arrows and slings, exiled on earth, at bay among the jeering crowd. He cannot walk for his unmanageable wings.
Thank you.
my arm, cruel and sullen thing, indolent beast, come to my arms again, or I would plunge my fingers in your mane and be a long time unremembering. And bury myself in you, and breathe your wild perfume remorselessly for one more hour, and breathe again as of a ruined flower, the fragrance of the love you have defiled. I long to sleep. I think that from a stark slumber like death I could awake the same as I was once and lavish without shame caresses upon your body, glowing in dark. To drown my sorrow, there is no abyss, however deep, that can compare with your bed. Forgetfulness has made its country in your red mouth, and the flowing of Lethe is in your kiss. My doom henceforward is my sole desire, as martyrs, being demented in their zeal, shake with delightful spasms upon the wheel, implore the whip, or puff upon the fire, so I implore you, fervently resigned, come. I would drink nepenthe and long rest the sweet points of this entrancing breast, wherein no heart has ever been confined.
Thank you.
autumn sky, but sadness mounts upon me like a flooding sea and ebbs, and ebbing leaves my lips morose and dry, smarting with faulty ooze, bitter with memory. Your hand like that along my breast. That which it seeks, my dear, is plundered. It is slit by the soft paw of woman that clawed while it caressed. Useless to hunt my heart, the beasts have eaten it. My heart is like a palace where the mob has spat. There they carouse, they seize each other's hair, they kill. Exotic scent is that? Oh, beauty, iron flail of soul, it is your will? So be it. Eyes of fire, bright in the darkness there, burn up these strips of flesh, the beasts soft fit to spare.